When I proposed to leave the Raspberry Pi for home server applications, many viewers wrote that Proxmox is now also available on the Pi. The Raspberry Pi 5 is much faster than the Pi 4. It comes with 8 GB of RAM and, with its low power consumption, should be a perfect fit for a Proxmox server. So let's check if this is true. And during this process, you will learn a few tricks for the Pi 5. Gritzy YouTubers, here is the guy with the Swiss accent, with a new episode and fresh ideas around sensors and microcontrollers. Remember, if you subscribe, you will always sit in the first row. After using Proxmox, most people do not look back because it is so easy to work with. Even easier than with Docker because of its graphical user interface. So I was curious to test it on a Pi 5 with ARM64 architecture. This is why I ordered one and started the experiment. In this video, we will try to install Proxmox on my Pi 5. Try to install Raspberry OS on Proxmox. Go on with other Linux distributions and Home Assistant OS. Try to install a few containers. Check out how hot the Pi gets with passive cooling. In the end, you should know if it is a valid alternative to a mini PC. The first thing I discovered was that the project is not from Proxmox itself. It is a fork maintained by some makers. But rumors are that it will shortly be supported by Proxmox too. So no reason to stop. Second, I found a rather complex installation video using an experimental UEFI bootloader on the Pi. Too complex for a simple man like me. Fortunately, I discovered this much simpler write-up and decided to use it for my experiments. But before we can start, we have to prepare our Pi 5 for its coming task. Because I do not like the sound of small fans, I decided on passive cooling. This heatsink is cheap, but we have to sacrifice the PoE connector because it does not fit under the top part. This is okay for me because I do not plan to use PoE with this Pi. Next, we have to decide on the installation media. I decided to use my trusty KingSpec USB SSD. You also could use an SD card or add the PCIe disk on one of the available adapters. While booting, the Pi 5 stopped because it did not like the additional load on a USB connector. I had to press the power button and it continued. I leave you a link where you can see how to avoid this step in the future. Of course, only if you have a potent power supply. Now we can install Proxmox. With this simple and well-documented write-up, it is installed in a few minutes, and we can log in to Proxmox running on a Raspberry Pi. And other than with the UEFI installation method, Ethernet works without the USB to Ethernet adapter. Easy! Now I could stop my video and say bye. Unfortunately, this is not true, as we will later see. Proxmox could be good for consolidating a few Raspberries into one because the Pi 5 has plenty of horsepower and, in the 8 GB version, enough memory for many Pi 4s or even more Pi 3s. So we start with installing the first virtual machine running Raspberry OS. If it works, we could add more VMs and, each time, save the hardware and the energy cost for one Pi board. But before, we have to do two things not needed on a standard Proxmox installation. We have to create a Linux bridge to access the internet. We do that on the Networks tab of our server and call it vmbridge0 as usual. Second, I discovered that the Pi rapidly consumes the standard swap file of 100 MB. This is anyway too small for an 8 GB system. So I leave you a link to a write-up on how to extend it. I used 1 GB and it was sufficient. To make it simple, I start with a light 64-bit version of Raspberry OS. First, we download the image to our PC and extract it. The resulting image file has to be uploaded to the Proxmox local disk into the ISO Images tab. With this image, we can create a virtual machine. We call it Raspberry Light and assign the image from before. We leave the System tab and, to preserve disk space, we assign 8 GB of disk. 2 CPU cores and 2 GB of memory are okay. In the Networking tab, we select No Firewall and ready is the virtual Raspberry Pi. We go to the console of the machine and start it. Unfortunately, we only get Display output is not active. Not very promising. Also, with other display settings, it does not work. The same happens to the full Raspberry Pi OS image with a desktop interface, by the way. So, let's try native Debian. I use this ISO file for the installation. Keep in mind, for the Raspberry, we need an Arch 64 image and not, as usual with Proxmox, one for x86. Unfortunately, we have the same problem as before. No display, but one CPU running at full throttle, producing nothing but warm air. As you know, I'm more of a Linux user than a Linux specialist. But I'm known for not giving up easily. So I started the usual try and error, and found out that by selecting the UEFI boot option, I was able to install Debian. The process is as always and takes a while. The Pi with passive cooling gets quite warm, but it does not start throttling. It seems that Raspbian and Debian are different. Maybe it's only a small switch to flip? Suggestions are welcome. With this tailwind, I continue with Ubuntu. Also here, after a few minutes, it works. Cool, without the desktop environment. But this is not a huge issue because Proxmox systems usually are used as servers. And for sure, we will find somebody who knows how to enable the desktop if we want. Let's continue with Fedora. Also here, I was able to install it. This time using the live image. So we go to the other important image. Home Assistant OS. I had to use the UEFI boot version and import this disk. Then it boots and we can log into our new instance of Home Assistant. I was even able to back up and restore my productive instance from my mini PC. So it should not be an issue to migrate your current installation on a Pi to a VM if you want to consolidate your Raspberries. So far, we have not been successful with Raspberry OS, but we were able to install other Linux distributions, some even with desktops. And we were able to install Home Assistant. Also, not the Raspberry version, but the generic ARM64 version. With my little Linux knowledge, I see a pattern. If we get images capable of using UEFI boot, they tend to work. If not, they do not work. I'm sure you will correct me if I'm wrong. As a last exercise, I will try to install OpenSense, because I found an installation file for ARM64. Unfortunately, OpenSense and PFSense are not officially available for the ARM architecture. I download and import this image into a newly created VM. But also OpenSense suffers the same issue. It shows display is not active. In addition to VMs, Proxmox also offers to run containers. We find all kinds of container images on this linuxcontainers.org page. Ubuntu and Alpine worked without problems and also had network connectivity. Debian and OpenWRT did not install. Now, what is my verdict after all those tests? Proxmox and the Raspberry Pi is no marriage made in heaven. Too big are the current differences. For Intel haters, ARM lovers, or if you want to play around, go for it. For all others, we have to wait and hope till Proxmox releases an official version and the Raspberry Pi officially supports UEFI boot and the Raspberry images are available for UEFI boot, or somebody tells us how we can overcome this issue. At least Raspberry OS has to be available till I again look into the matter. You see quite a lot of and. So Docker is still the best solution if we want to run containers on a Raspberry Pi. And for Proxmox, a mini PC is the right choice. This was all for today. As always, you find all the relevant links in the description. I hope this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If true, please consider supporting the channel to secure its future existence. Thank you. Bye.